better, okay. All right, well, I'll turn it off here in a second so I can blend in with the voices of the Tabernacle Choir here at St. John's United Church of Christ. I appreciate these folks. They do a great job. And we are doing it the second Sunday. You're splitting the first Sunday with Bill and Carol. We're all enjoying themselves. And Branson, right, Bill?
Yes, sir.
Amen. Is there anything new going on in Branson that we need to know about?
It's a good place. There's a Bible Belt, and they had a lot of good shows and some around the city.
Amen. Amen. Well, we're glad you got to get away.
Wow.
Amen. Amen. I've never been there, but maybe someday. Should I add that to my bucket list?
Add that to your bucket list.
All right, good deal. All right, well, what song have you picked out, sir, for this morning?
In my heart, rings a melody. We'll sing all three verses.
Amen.
You and our organist, I told her, even.
Everybody's in the know today.
Breakfast of Blessings is for August 13th from 8:30 Cyrus is trying. See Tanner Carroll if you're interested in helping with this ministry. Pastor Wendell is scheduling home visits for July and August for all who are interested. Please speak with Pastor directly or call the church office during normal hours to schedule a visit. Today's flowers are given by Jim Haig and Maria Jones. And our third Sunday thing will be next Sunday, July 17th, Be Thinking About Your Secrets. Our Women's Guild will be meet Thursday, July 28th at noon in the Church Fellowship Hall. This group is open to all the ladies and their friends. Lunch will be served. And please sign up on the bulletin board so we can plan for it. Our church picnic is planned for Sunday, July 31st. A sign-up sheet for side dishes and desserts is on the bulletin board for the next week. Our service will be indoors on a casual Sunday, but the pavilion will be open outside for anyone who would like to eat outside. Looking ahead to August, our church will host the Just for Strummers ukulele group during the regular Sunday service on August 14th. All are welcome, refreshments, and fellowship after the service.
Any other announcements that we need to make or slip past? Anything from you, our fearless leader, Mr. Hagen?
No, there will be fair parking sign-ups. We haven't got the schedule up yet.
Okay, all right. Is there a meeting this Thursday for a council or no?
Probably should.
Okay. All right. Well, if you get a notification, council members, that there's a meeting, there will be one. All right. Thank you. Anything else? Anything else? Okay.
So let's please stand. Those who are able for our call to worship. Forgive us, O Lord, and do good to us even when we have trouble doing good for others.
Lead us by your example and surround us with your love.
Surround us with your grace and with your peace.
Surround us with the Spirit of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior.
You can remain standing or be seated, your choice. But you're going to have to get back up for the invitation that's happened anyway. So if that up and down gets you, just stay up. 307. There is a name I love to hear. Let's do 1 and 4, Laura.
To save us.
He is our hope and good news.
Thank you.
Thank you.
them with kindness. I love that. That's a good attitude. Amen. Thank you, kids. Thank you, folks, for your contributions today to the Ever Fund. All right, Jill has some scripture for us today.
Our scripture is from John 5:17-27. But Jesus answered them, "My Father worketh hitherto, and I work." Therefore the Jews sought the more to kill him, because he not only had broken the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself equal with God. Then answered Jesus and said unto them, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, the Son can do nothing of himself but what he seeth the Father do. For what things soever he doeth, he also doeth the Son likewise. For the Father loveth the Son, and sheweth him all things that himself doeth. And he shew them greater works than these, that ye may mark them. For as the Father raiseth up the dead and quickeneth them, even so the Son quickeneth whom he will. For the Father judgeth no man, but hath committed all judgment unto the Son, that all men should honor the Son even as they honor the Father. He that honoreth not the Son honoreth not the Father which hath sent him. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that heareth my word and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life, and shall not come into condemnation, but is passed from the death unto life."
Amen. Amen. Dale, thank you so much.
There's some three words in there. Bless
you. Is it really?
There is. Still 25 verses.
My bad. Go ahead. Never mind. Continue, please.
Verily, verily, I say unto you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead shall hear the voice of the Son of God, and that they here shall live. For the Father hath life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and hath given him authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. These are the words of our Lord.
Amen. Amen. David the pastor messed things up, right? Amen. I am so sorry.
It was a long story.
So sorry. Yeah, I was looking at exactly where she was reading, and I don't know how I got my verses mixed up. Great job. Thank you, Jill. Appreciate you joining the rotation. Boy, I tell you, who likes it hot? Okay, got a good contingency there that likes it hot. Listen, I wasn't expecting quite that fanfare, but it beats 10 below zero, doesn't it? That's for sure. Well, we've got a lot going on. And on the church Facebook page, we have posted pictures of one of the was that an oak tree, Jim, that was cut down?
Yeah. Yes.
Okay, yes. That's a big old oak tree that was hanging over the pavilion shed. I guess it's out back here, right? Over there. And right over there. And so that's been taken out. So I call that as you're going by it. It looks real good. Thanks for everybody that had a part in that coming down. And if you're needing some wood, right there it is, right? Amen. Well, this has been promised to somebody else. You can just see Santa Claus. He's the wood gifter at this point, I would imagine. Well, we're glad that you're here. We're glad that you're watching online. We're grateful for you today. We're thankful for God and for his blessings. There's a lot going on in America today. Our theme has been the Gospel of John, bringing it forward into 2022. The scripture that Jill has read for us today, she calls all of us to pause and think. And sometimes we have those moments, you know, where we just, me personally, I just put my hands on my cheeks and I go, what am I going to do next? What do we need to do next? And one of those moments was strange. I was sharing some video. My grandsons and my son and his family are in Elizabethtown, Kentucky, which is a southern suburb of Louisville, Kentucky. And My son was driving down there Thursday after I met with him when we had had a little fellowship time together while he was getting his car serviced. And then he was heading down there to prepare for this tournament. And it's one of those things where, I mean, I enjoy my son. My son is, well, let me think for a second. I think he's 40, he's either 41 or 42, early 40s. And so a lot of times when we get to be that age, we're visiting with family and things like that, you don't have time for mom and dad, you know? So any time he wants to spend with me, I'm grateful for it. I enjoy talking with my son. He's stuck with my name, so he's Wendell Jr. So anyway, so when we went to Starbucks and we sat down and they asked for a name, I said, Wendell! And he says, that goes for both of us. So we were good to go. But where I'm going at with this story is that we finished up our visit about an hour later after they serviced his car, and my son hit about 65, Interstate 65, and headed down toward Kentucky. And I get a phone call from him. And that was about 11 o'clock that he left. I get a phone call from him about 3:30, almost 4 o'clock. And he says, Dad, he goes, I'm not quite there yet. I've been in an accident. And I mean, it's just, the hair in the back of my neck and everything just kind of raised up. And of course, I mean, I'm talking to him, so I know he's alive. I know that much, right? I know he's alive. I know he's probably okay. But I could hear the rattle in his voice. I could hear the not tremor or anything like that, but I could tell that it wasn't his normal jovial self that he'd been through something. As we begin to talk to him, he explained to me what happened, how he was sideswiped there coming into Louisville, and then the guy just hit him and went on. Hit him and went on. And he was trying to call 911, was trying to get a police report, and they couldn't get an officer there. And when he did get a, when he finally did get a number to call, he kept getting a voicemail. Because place wasn't staffed at that time of day or whatever. But he finally got all of that taken care of. As we talked later on, and he was, took a deep breath, we both said to each other, isn't it amazing how in the course of just that second, that blink of an eye, that moment, however you want to describe it, that everything can change. Everything can change. I could have lost him. He could have been gone. I could have lost a son. His three kids could have lost a father. The place where he works would have lost a manager and the dozen or so people that he supervised. Everybody's world would change just in that moment. Just in that moment. I thank God for his protective hand upon him. He was able to. Right now they're playing a ball game down there. He's able to manage and do what he went down there for with his boys, his team. He's able to do that. But cherish the moments. Cherish family. I think part of what the Gospel of John bringing it into the day that we live in today should tell us that Jesus' importance that he put on life. He says, I've come to give you life and to give it to you abundantly. God wants the very best for each one of us. He wants the best for each one of you. I could go through, I could name you each one by name. God wants the best for Wendell. He wants the best for Perry. He wants the best for Bobby. The best for Kevin, for Jill. He wants the best for all of us, for Audrey, Irene and Bob, and we go back. Each one. He wants the best for you. And the great lie that Satan continues, he's been selling this lie since the Garden of Eden, that God is holding out on us. That he's holding back the good things that we could have if we just followed his ways. Satan's ways. Bible tells us in Proverbs that there's a way that seemeth right unto man, unto mankind. There's a way that seems right, but the end thereof are the ways of death. If we follow our own way, our own heart, our own will, led by the one that we know as Satan, that great devil, Peter talks about him in 1 Peter 5:8. He says, you know, the devil goes about as a lion, seeking whom he may devour. He has one course of action in mind, and that's destruction of anybody and of everybody, just to get back at God. The book of John today should give us the hope that Jesus is alive, that Jesus is well. I'm glad today that I know who Jesus is. I'm glad today I know that he's more than just a story. More than just a story. He is the King of glory. I'm glad I know who Jesus is. And some of the readings that I'll do in my morning reading to the news and junk like that, you know, try to keep up on current events and things like that. I was reading about a recent poll. Show of hands here. Who has heard of a Gallup poll over the course of their life? Okay, most everybody. George Gallup is a pollster going back, I don't know how many years, but as long as I can remember. But he asked questions about everything. Now, one of the recent questions he asked from the religious perspective was, how many people, and he's been asking this question over a number of years too, how many people believe that the Bible is the literal word of Almighty God? Kevin does. Kevin's just voting. But that's the question he asked Kevin. So you would have been a positive response. But he's been asking this question over the years. Now, I asked this question back in 1980. Anybody care to render a guess of how many people back in 1980 felt that the Bible was the literal word of God? Anybody with a guess?
90%. 90%?
That's a good guess. It's high, but it's still a good guess. You were alive in the 1980s, right? You remember the 80s, Chris?
Yes.
There was a lot of bad stuff going on in the 80s. But she had confidence in people at 90%. So that's a good guess. That's a good guess. Anybody else? It's not quite that high. 70 is a better guess. Anybody go lower?
55.
Perry's not going lower. I hear a couple of us.
65.
And in 1980, 52% felt that the Bible, so that's roughly half, that the Bible was the Word of God. Do you think it has gone up or down when he asked this question a couple months ago, March of 2022? Why?
Because people are stupid.
So are you saying then, I mean, I hear your laughter, but are you saying then that we have not improved ourselves? Isn't that one of the monikers of modern day society today, that we know more today than we knew 40 years ago? Isn't that what we say? We're smarter?
Yeah,
right. Isn't that one of the things that they say in the business world today, that we work smarter, not harder? The world will tell us a lot that we are smarter. We have more today. And there are technologies, and there's inventions, and there's all of these things. And I'm not diminishing those things or their importance. But are we better? Are we smarter toward the one that framed the worlds and the word that he spoke to us? Does anybody care to render a guess as to what the percentage was that Gallup found that said, yes, I believe the Bible is the literal word of God in 2022? Anyone? 45, 50, the same? 38, 39? Anybody else?
31.
United States. United States of America is what we're talking about. 22. Are you reading my mind, Barb? That's a bad place to be. Get out of my head. Bless your heart. You just nailed it. 22% said that they felt the Bible is the literal word of God. Down from 40 years ago, where 52%. Folks, you don't have to be a mathematician to know that it's fallen roughly half. So as we look forward into the upcoming decades of our country, if God should not come back, and what does the Bible tell us about itself? What does God tell us in these times that we could consider as our prophetic times? My father likes to call these the days of sorrow that the Lord speaks of in Matthew 24. If God does not come back, the scripture tells us that he has to cut our time short here on earth, or he would find no faith at all. And yet we feel we're improving ourselves. We're smarter. We know more. And that's the problem we run into. We feel that we know more than God. And it's the same lie that Satan fed Eve back in the Garden of Eden. Eve, look at that tree. It's better than the trees that you're eating of. There's no reason in the world why you shouldn't be eating of that tree. Well, the Lord said that it's forbidden. You can't eat of it. Well, that's not a good reason. You know more than he does. That's not what he said verbatim, but it's the gist of it. You know more than he does, and how much in your life and in my life, I'm speaking personal experience here, folks, has he come at you? He's come at me. He says, well, you know you're not supposed to be doing that or do that or be here or be a part of this. And Satan says to you, well, so what? You know more than God does. Satan has carried the Garden of Eden into 2022. It's the same plan. It's the same tack. It's the same overshadowing of you know more than God. Why is that percentage down to what Barb said it is, 22%? Because the world today, when I say world, I'm talking specifically about the United States with that poll. The United States of America, a nation that was founded with liberty and justice under God. We know more than God. We'll tell God a thing or two. I'll never forget my conversation with a guy one time. And he literally said to me, he says, because I said, one day you'll stand before God and you'll give an account for your life and for your choices and for your sin. He said, and Jesus died for your sins. And I shared the gospel with him. And to his credit, he allowed me to finish. But when I finished, he said, one day I will not kneel before God. I will stand before him, and I will shake my fist in his face. And I'll tell him a thing or two about how he runs the world. Woo! What I did at that moment was I was this close to him, Perry. I took a couple steps back. Just in case the lightning bolt came, I didn't want to get caught awake. But you know, what he said, he meant. And maybe in his heart he thought that's the way it will work out. But if my Bible and your Bible is true, we can turn over to Philippians chapter 2 and verse 10, and we can see where the Apostle Paul said, under the leadership and guidance of the Holy Spirit, that one day every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that he, meaning God, Jesus Christ, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, is Lord of all things. That man may not think he'll kneel, but he will. Why? Not because Pastor Wendell says he will. Because God Almighty says, one day he will. One day. And that's the message that we have to get out to folks, not to scare people, not to judge them. A lot of times when I tell folks, I say, well, you know, you need to stop doing whatever they're doing. It was obviously they're wrong, or they've been talking to them. Oh, well, you're judging me. No, I'm not judging. I'm trying to tell you that the path that you're on and where it's going, and God has something better for you. If you'll open your eyes and see it. If you'll see it. In 2022, our job has not changed. It's not diminished. I will grant you this, it's gotten a lot harder. Because the percentage of people that believe continues to drop. Is that my fault? Is that your fault? Is it our fault as believers, as churches across America? A lot of it probably is. But I know in churches across, a lot of churches across America, and I don't say this to offend anyone, but they're more social clubs than they are gospel preaching places of truth. I heard of churches where the minister starts out by reading from the newspaper from the pulpit instead of the Bible as the Word of God. I heard one pastor open Newsweek magazine one time and says, I found this interesting article. Let's talk about it today. I want to get your thoughts on it. There's a time and a place for all those discussions. I'm not saying those things are wrong. Political issues, social issues, whatever it is. But you know, when we come into here, and as we take here out into there, into our homes, into our businesses, into our places of work, into the schools, wherever we're at, we take Jesus with us. And he wants to be used. He wants to use us, rather, as his ambassadors in 2022. The Father worked through the Son, the scripture that Jill was reading for us. And the Son wants to work through us, as the Father wants to work through the Son to work through us to carry the gospel. To those 78% of people who don't believe that the Bible is the Word of God. Well, that'll really curl the hair on the back of your neck when you think of that, right? 22% of the people believe that the Bible is the Word of God. That means that 78% don't. If you're batting 78%, Bill, in the big leagues, or Dave, if you're batting that in the big leagues, that'll get you a nice payday, won't it? 780. You're getting ahead 78 times out of 100. That'll keep you in the big leagues. That'll put you in the Hall of Fame probably before you even retire. But that's how many don't believe. You've got to share the truth with them, folks. So many people are looking for political change. So basically, what are we looking for? We're looking for people to change things who don't even believe. Most coming to believe that the Bible is the Word of God. Wow. Makes me stop and think. regardless of political party or persuasion or anything like that. Political change is not the answer. Spiritual change is where it has to start. God said to his people back in the Old Testament, 1 Chronicles 7:14, if my people who are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face, then I will heal their land. We're there in 2022, folks. God wants to use us. He needs us to be his ambassadors. Are you willing? Are you able? Do you know him as your Savior? If you're watching online and you've never trusted Christ as your Savior, I invite you to trust him today. There's three simple steps. You admit that you're a sinner to him. You don't got to share anything with me or anybody else. Admit to God you're a sinner. Believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for your sins. Confess those sins to him. You don't have to name them one by one. He knows what they are. He knows your heart. You've got to confess them to him. Ask him to forgive you. You know what the Bible says? That he will, if you ask. Whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord, Romans 10:14, shall be saved. Shall be saved. Saved from what? Saved from their sins. Because the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Do you know him today? Are you his ambassador today? Let's bring John into 2022 and reflect Christ's love today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. All right. You want to stretch your legs? Feel free. Turn to page number 372. We're into the first and the last verse of Jesus Keeping the Year Cross. can around for years to come. Tell me that I'm not singing all the verses. Amen. Well, let's remember them in prayers as they come up to this this here in just a few weeks, okay? Again, so I was sharing with Jan earlier, we rejoiced with her last week. His little Noah is doing so much better. We're thankful for that wonderful news, and we appreciate that. And all the prayers for those who prayed for that little guy. Amen. Others, and it's good to have Donna back with us. Donna had a little bit of a back set here last week, and she's in the hospital for a few days. She said she's not ready to run a marathon yet, but she's feeling a lot better, right? Amen. God bless you. Good to have you and Jim back. And who else? Yes?
Emily Recchia, that we've been praying for. Yes. Years. She's in the bulletin, 34 years old. She died Wednesday.
Emily passed. Oh, I'm so sorry.
It's our son-in-law's niece.
Just such a young lady. Oh my goodness, I'm so sorry for lost your family, Carol. Remember Emily's family, Bill and Carol's, everyone there. Pray for them in such a difficult time. Thank you, Carol. Okay. Yes? Service with us. You feeling okay, Mike?
I feel okay.
Amen. You probably feel a lot better if the White Sox were winning more games, wouldn't you?
Well, it's better than being with some other teammates.
You know, I'm not even going to argue that with you. I'll just say touche and thank you. God bless you, buddy. Amen. Good to have Jerry and Kathy back with us today, too. So, always good to always good to have family back. Yes?
No one online has requested anything yet, but Sam, my daughter-in-law, her grandmother passed away yesterday.
Oh my goodness, okay. Sam's
affectionately known as Bernani.
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 So she was probably here at the
hospital.
Remember Samantha's
Nani.
Okay. Bless her heart. Okay. Anybody else? Yeah?
People at Hyman Park
Illinois. Amen. As many of you know, since we met last on July 4th, Highland Park has become a world-renowned place because of the actions of one person.
Pray for his soul, too, on
the
trouble he must see.
A very deeply troubled young man. Yes. Bobby Cremo, is that his name? Mm-hmm. We pray for him. It's hard to do things like that. It's hard, you know. So refrain from further comment again. That's a very, very specific need, Gail. Thank you. Thank you for bringing in the Highland Park folks. And as many had burials yesterday, I saw on the news. Pray for them. Yes, Bobby?
Hates the 4th of July and making threats at him.
pray for the hearts of these folks. It's sad. I mean, and please don't anybody be angry at me about this, but any of these weapons, none of them in and of themselves, choose to hurt anyone. But in the hands of people with hearts that are cold, hearts that are attuned to wrong things, they choose to do harm. And we pray for those. And we just heard with them as you're sharing about it. When will it stop? Because it shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. Who else? Unspoken? God sees hands and hearts. Let's go from there. Give them all in the silence, and I'll pray, and then we'll do the Lord's Prayer together. Father God, we thank you for your blessings in our lives today. We know we live in a world today, Lord, that's more confused and in more turmoil than probably at any time in history. Just the crux of this message today, Lord, is to present to your people that believe your word is your word. God, use us. I'm drawing a circle right now. Let revival, let your spirit use me to touch someone's heart this week. But I may not be able to change the world this week, but Father, I can touch someone if you'll use me. And God, I pray that each one of us in this auditorium today, that we would pray a prayer similarly, that you can use someone. You can put someone in their path, someone in their life this week, that through them you can touch. Use them as your ambassador this week. Let that begin with us. God, help us to be different. Help us to be examples. Help us to show your love. And God, for these that have been mentioned today, the Jensen's, Lord, Emily Recchia. It's a close family member, Father, we pray for Emily's family. He's passed at such a young age. We pray for one Jane mentioned, Andrew, with a kidney failure, needing a new kidney again. We pray for him. Pray for Samantha's family of the loss of her precious grandmother, her known as Carol Paul. Pray for those affected in Highland Park this past week, Lord. Several lost their lives. And the thread of that goes through so many families so much deeper. Pray for what Bobby's just brought to us, Lord, too. Those that hate America, what they believe, why they believe it, we have a hard time understanding when you blessed us so. But we pray for these. We pray for responsible use of weaponry. For those, Lord, that are granted that privilege. We pray for the unspoken requests, the uplifted hands. We pray for the heart of America. And for the heart of the world, Lord, the world needs Jesus. It's in his name we pray. Amen. God's people said together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Usher's going to come at this time. We're going to receive our Sunday morning offering. You can give, you know, the cause of the church, both in our community and overseas. Please do that. If you're watching online, you can give. There's a giving tool there you can use if that's convenient to you. We'd be happy to receive your check here at the church office. Most days of the week, when you ask the attendant to, we can draw something in there. It's okay to. Usher's good.
Can make me whole again. Thank you. Yeah, sure.
Because then I don't have to go, okay, okay.
I pick up his own.
Bonnie, one more.
Chris Wilson.
Bonnie.
He's down, it's okay. Got her out of